Well, good morning, friends. It's great to be with you on this fourth Sunday after Pentecost. And we're going to begin today with our confession and forgiveness. We gather, even in this digital way, in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. God of all mercy and consolation, come to the help of your people, turning us from sin to live for you alone. Give us the power of your Holy Spirit, that we may confess our sin, receive your forgiveness, and grow into the fullness of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Let us confess our sins in the presence of God and of one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us, forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. My friends, God, who is rich in mercy, has promised to forgive us for our sins. And so, for the sake of Jesus Christ and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And now let's join together in singing our first hymn. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. And now let us pray together. O God, you direct our lives by your grace, and your words of justice and mercy reshape the world. Mold us into a people who welcome your word and serve one another through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Our first reading today comes from the book of Jeremiah, where the prophet writes, "The prophet Jeremiah spoke to the prophet Hananiah in the presence of the priests and all the people who were standing in the house of the Lord. And the prophet Jeremiah said, 'Amen. May the Lord do so. May the Lord fulfill the words that you have prophesied and bring back to this place from Babylon the vessels of the house of the Lord and all the exiles. But listen now to this word that I speak in your hearing and in the hearing of all the people. The prophets who preceded you and me from ancient times prophesied war, famine, and pestilence against many countries and great kingdoms. As for the prophet who prophesies peace, when the word of that prophet comes true, then it will be known that the Lord has truly sent his prophet. Our psalm today is number 89, and we're going to read it responsively. So I'll be reading along with you, and Heidi will be leading the leader parts.
Your love, O Lord, forever will I sing. From age to age, my mouth will proclaim your faithfulness.
For I am persuaded that your steadfast love is established forever. You have set your faithfulness firmly in the heavens.
A covenant with my chosen one, I have sworn an oath to David, my servant.
I will establish your line forever and preserve your throne for all generations.
Happy are the people who know the festal shout. They walk, O Lord, in the light of your presence.
They rejoice daily in your name. They are jubilant in your righteousness.
For you are the glory of their strength, and by your favor our might is exalted.
Truly our shield belongs to the Lord, our King to the Holy One of Israel. We're going to turn now to the gospel reading, and I hope that you will join along with us, hallelujahs, as we sing together the gospel acclamation.
Open now our hearts to hear, and let the word of God draw near, the gospel word that is our holy treasure. We stand as if the Lord is here, we feel his presence coming near. Lord, speak today, tomorrow, and forever. Alleluia. 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 Alleluia.
Gospel for today is taken from the 10th chapter of the Gospel according to St. Matthew. Glory to you, O Lord. Jesus said to the 12, "Whoever welcomes you welcomes me, and whoever welcomes me welcomes the one who sent me. Whoever welcomes a prophet in the name of a prophet will receive a prophet's reward. And whoever welcomes a righteous person in the name of a righteous person will receive a righteous person's reward. And whoever gives even a cup of water, a cup of cool water, to one of these little ones in the name of a disciple, truly I tell you, none of these will lose their reward." The Gospel of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Dear friends in Christ, grace and peace to you from God, our Heavenly Father, and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Well, are you ready this week for a little good news? You may remember our reading last week was filled with gloom and doom. Jesus almost seemed like he was having a bad day. He was saying things like, I came not to bring peace, but a sword. And I came to divide fathers from sons and mothers from daughters. Well, today he's changed his mood a bit, and he's telling us something very wonderful and very filled with hope. Actually, what he says today follows immediately on what he was just saying from last week's reading, because what he's doing in this section of Matthew is giving a set of instructions to his disciples. And now today we receive the very final part of his instructions. You might think about it as maybe the last class of the semester. And he's filled with good news today, and it's time for us to hear what he's got to say. He ends on this pleasing tone that says that those who serve God will receive their reward in heaven. If anyone welcomes a servant of Christ, it's the same as welcoming Christ. And if anyone welcomes Christ, it's the same as welcoming the one, the God the Father that sent him. And then he says, when you bring the gospel news, if it is welcomed by anyone that listens to it, they too will receive the reward, the same reward as the one who brought it. If anyone is a teacher of the faith, all who welcome that teaching, all of the people that welcome your teaching, will receive the same reward that you receive. And if you are a missionary for the gospel, all the people that receive the good news from the missionary will receive the same reward as the one who brought it. Wonderful news. Now, I really like the last line of this lesson today. It says, whoever gives a cup of cool water to any disciple of Jesus, has their reward in heaven. Isn't that wonderful news? Of course, not everyone will be a prophet. Not everyone can be a righteous teacher. Not everyone can be a missionary. But everyone can do something so simple and humble as to serve their neighbor, perhaps with a cup of cool water. I remember when I was back on internship in northern Minnesota, a small town, and as the intern pastor, I oftentimes would go to the various Bible studies, and there was a newspaper in that small town that would record community events. And for some reason, they liked to record things like Bible studies at Martha Johnson's house. And if I would go, and I happened to be the person that would pick up the coffee pot and start to pour coffee in everyone's cup, which is a simple enough thing to do, well, the newspaper would record that. It would say, and the pastor poured, as if that were any news at all. They didn't say anything about the people that made the coffee, didn't say anything about Mrs. Johnson and Mrs. Henderson, who might have made the cherry delights and the pineapple upside-down cake that everyone was eating. No mention of that at all. In fact, the people would not have wanted any mention of that. They just were doing what they always do. They're serving their friends coffee and treats. Somehow the pastor had to be noticed. Today, with this good news from Jesus, what we want to do is take a few moments to give thanks to God for all of those people that do serve in such quiet and wonderful ways. Now, you have heard me say many times here at Trinity that I'm just so delighted about the endless list of things that people do in this community of faith and out in our local community to serve Christ. We do it in so many ways, and I should probably stop mentioning it because sooner or later it might get in the way of the beautiful work that you do. If you make a lot of noise about something that's very quiet, sooner or later it's not going to be quiet anymore, and it may affect the service. I'm reminded of my brother who was never a golfer, but he went to an event and he won a set of golf clubs. So we said, well, we've got to take you out golfing. You're going to love it. But my brother disparaged golf. He thought it was a silly game. He called it barnyard pool. He certainly thought there was nothing to it. You hit a ball, you chase it around the field. What can be hard about that? So we talked him into, because he now had a set of clubs himself, we talked him into going golfing with us. So we showed him how to grip the club, and we showed him how to make a good swing and place the ball and all of that. So he takes his driver out, and he stands up, he lines up, takes a big full swing, and he hit that ball a half a mile, straight and true and beautiful. And we all stood around oohing and aahing and telling him, what a great shot that was. We can't believe it. Your first golf shot. It was just magnificent. He just shrugged his shoulders and we walked off to hit the second shot. Second shot was not quite so good for him, but it was pretty good. Third shot, fourth shot, he got up to the green with a pretty good score. But as the game went on, you can imagine what happened. because we were telling him how magnificent it was and he must be a natural, he begins to care about what happens with his golf shots. And so the more he cares, the more he begins to overthink it, the more he begins to overgrip, the more he begins to overwork the whole situation until finally every shot he hits is just exactly like a rank amateur, like someone who has never held a club before. The ball would go off to the right, the ball would go off to the left. He'd top the ball, it'll dribble a few feet in front of the tee. And he slowly began to realize that golf is actually a difficult game. And he began to realize why we were so impressed. He never in his life played as well as he did that first one hole on that golf course. You see, if we overthink things, we can ruin them. And if we overthink our humble service, then that overthinking can get in the way. Our German theologian friend Dietrich Bonhoeffer once wrote a book called The Cost of Discipleship, and he speaks about an amazing paradox that takes place in Christian service. This is what he says. He says we should attempt to do this. Let your light shine before others, but at the same time, hide it. We have to take heed that we do not take heed of our own righteousness. In other words, he's saying what Jesus said in another place. When you serve someone, do not let your right hand know what your left hand is doing. So, today, I am going to resist mentioning all of those wonderful services that we do at Trinity. I'm going to resist all those humble things that people do and love to do here and in the community. I'm going to resist talking about the ushers and the acolytes, the people that take communion to the homebound. I'm not going to mention those who fill the little food pantry or drive for Meals on Wheels or visit people in jail and in prison. I'm going to try to resist to talk about the women who make afghans and quilts, or now who are making face masks for all of us. I'm not going to mention those who pick up groceries for at-risk friends or make phone calls to cheer up neighbors. No, I'm going to resist mentioning any of those things today. But there is one kind of service I think I would like to lift up today, because it is so critical to our well-being, both as a community here and as a nation. I want to lift up before us today those who have placed themselves on the front lines of service in the hospitals and clinics battling on our behalf this infection that has gripped our nation. I may have mentioned before a friend of mine, her name is Sue, who is a captain in the Naval Reserve. She's also a nurse, and she got, two or three months ago, she got notice that she was being called up with a whole bunch of other people to go to New York City to step into the jaw of the monster and begin serving in the hospitals there at Ground Zero. And so they all went. They all went and they donned their face masks and their shields, and they put on their protective clothing, and they marched right into those hospital rooms, and they did everything they could to eradicate the disease and to save lives. They worked 16, 18-hour a day work days, and they were completely exhausted. You've all seen the pictures on television and the news of this heroic work that they were doing. These people really served in such a way that was completely filled with joy and completely humble. They never asked for any recognition. They were entirely unheralded. But once in a while, it's good to stop and pause and think about that and thank God for the people that serve in that way. So that's one group I'd like to lift up today. And then while I'm at it, I'd also like to lift up those who serve in elderly care homes and nursing homes, whether they're administrators who keep the records or custodians who keep the rooms clean, or nurses and nursing assistants who help to keep the patients clean. Whatever their service is, we thank God for them as well today, for the selfless service that they offer to our friends. Of course, there are many kinds of humble service in the world, in the kingdom of God, and we cannot possibly highlight them all. And it would be wrong to make too much of any of them, I suppose, lest we begin to actually take heed of our own righteousness. But the good news, my friends, today is that Jesus is not unaware of all of the ways that you are serving one another. all the ways that you're serving Christ, and by serving him, serving God. And the Christ whom you serve is the same Christ that establishes the reward that awaits those who serve him with a quietness of spirit and mind. So today, along with Jesus, we honor and give thanks for all the humble servants who, in one way or another, offer a cup of cool water to their neighbors. Amen. And now I'd like to invite you to join me as we turn to our hymn.
And all can safely live, a place where saints and children tell how hearts yearn to forgive. Built of hopes and dreams and visions, rock of faith and vault of grace, here the love of Christ shall end divisions. All are welcome, all are welcome, all are welcome in this place. Let us build a house where prophets speak and words are strong and true, where all God's children dare to seek to dream God's reign anew. Hear the court shall stand as witness and as symbol of God's grace. Here as one we claim the faith of Jesus. All are welcome, all are welcome, all are welcome in this place. Let us build a house where love is found in water, wine, and wheat. A banquet hall on holy ground where peace and justice meet. Hear the love of God through Jesus is revealed in time and space. As we share in Christ the feast that frees us, all are welcome, all are welcome, all are welcome in this place. Let us build a house where hands will reach beyond the wood and stone, to heal and strengthen, serve and teach, and live the word they've known. Hear the outcast and the stranger, bear the image of God's face. Let us bring an end to fear and danger. All are welcome, all are welcome, all are welcome in this place. Let us build a house where all are named, their songs and visions heard, and loved and treasured, taught and claimed as words within the word. Built of tears and cries and laughter, prayers of faith and songs of grace, let this house proclaim from floor to rafter, all are welcome, all are welcome, all are welcome in this place.
And now let us turn to our creed, the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Today for special music, we have a really wonderful treat. It's not every day that a congregation can invite the St. Olaf Choir in to sing for us, but as many have, they've been putting some things online, and they did one of these digital recordings with all the voices woven together. They did this recently, and they did it just for people who are looking for music during this wonderful time. They're going to sing for us their theme song, which is Beautiful Savior. So please enjoy now the St. Olaf Choir right here at Trinity Lutheran Church in Stevens Point. And as we turn to our prayers now, we remember all of those people in our community, our congregation, and around the nation that have special needs. So today I will once again call out the topic for prayer and ask each of you to pray aloud or perhaps silently in your heart, there in your homes. Let us pray for our relationships in Christ, those in this congregation, those among other believers and friends in many denominations, and for our relationship with our Lutheran friends at the St. Katharina Parish in South Africa. Let's pray today for the growing season, that food will be plentiful for all creatures, that weather will be favorable for harvesting, and that we all care for God's beautiful creation. Let's pray for God's mercy to inspire authorities, judges, and politicians to act with compassion, especially during these difficult days. Let's pray that God help us to overcome fear with hope, to meet hate with love, and to welcome diverse faces and voices in our circles of trust. Let's pray today that God will accompany all who are in deepest need, especially those who are sick, lonely, or abandoned. We pray especially today for Rita, recovering from surgery, and we continue to pray for Doris, having lost her brother and sister-in-law to COVID. Let's pray that God will strengthen those in prison or those caught up in the criminal justice system. And let's pray with gratitude for the gift of this congregation and all the friendships that knit us together and the mission that God gives us in our community. And let us pray that the Holy Spirit will continue to guide us in our mission here at Trinity of worship, witness, and service. Into your hands, O God, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. May the peace of Christ be with you always. And please take a moment to greet the friends and family around you in your home, or perhaps to make a phone call later to greet someone with the peace of Christ and let them know that God is still with us. And let us now pray together the prayer that Jesus gave us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And now, my friends, as we conclude our service, I want to share this benediction with you. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. And let's join together in singing our final hymn, Amazing Grace, How Sweet the Sound.
Sweet the sound that saves.
see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace.
My friends, go forth into the world to serve God with gladness. Be of good courage. Hold fast to that which is good. Render to no one evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted. Support the weak. Help the afflicted. Honor all people. Love and serve God, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. Thanks be to God.